Hermanos, mi nombre es Carlos Alberto Castaño Arango, sacerdote de los Siervos del Espíritu Santo de Colombia, asesor de la Renovación Carismática Católica. ¡Qué maravillosa esta experiencia de la renovación! ¡Qué hermoso ese regalo que nos da el Señor por la fuerza del Espíritu Santo para vivir en este ambiente y en esta cultura de Pentecostés! Se me ha pedido que hable de el carisma o de la palabra de conocimiento, antes llamada en muchos lugares como logosofía, palabra de sabiduría, pero el verdadero original es logos, gnosis, que es palabra de conocimiento. Y nos dice la palabra de Dios en la primera carta de los Corintios en el capítulo 12, 8, nos dice así: a uno se le da por el Espíritu palabra de sabiduría, a otro palabra de conocimiento según el mismo Espíritu Santo. En ese documento maravilloso de la Congregación para la Fe sobre la Iglesia Rejuvenece, que nos habla sobre los dones y los carismas que hacen viva a la Iglesia, se nos dice que el Espíritu Santo se regala para la comunidad a través de las personas, que los carismas que recibimos no son para edificación propia, sino para edificación de la Iglesia. En esta palabra de conocimiento, o llamada también sabiduría, o llamada también don de ciencia o palabra de ciencia, Falvio define así este carisma. Nos dice: es una revelación sobrenatural de situaciones, de hechos, de sucesos pasados, prudentes y futuros que no son conocidos por medios humanos. Es un fragmento del conocimiento de Dios revelado a nuestra inteligencia, que se relaciona con hechos determinados. No es pues la ciencia aún teológica que adquirimos con la reflexión o el estudio. Monseñor Alfonso Uribe Jaramillo nos decía que no es solamente un mero conocimiento intelectual. Nos decían unas bellas palabras, Monseñor, que había que pedirle al Espíritu Santo que bajara solamente una cuarta, de la mente al corazón. Escrutar desde lo más íntimo de nuestro ser con la fuerza del Espíritu Santo. Pero diríamos también todos nosotros, como lo dice también Santo Tomás, el don de ciencia es un hábito sobrenatural, infundido por Dios con la gracia santificante en el entendimiento del hombre, para que por obra del Espíritu Santo juzgue rectamente, con lucidez sobrehumana, acerca de todas las cosas creadas, refiriéndolas siempre a su fin sobrenatural. Por tanto, en la consideración del mundo visible, el don de ciencia perfecciona la virtud de la fe, dando a éste una luminosidad de conocimiento al modo divino. Bajo esta luminosidad del conocimiento, la persona habla bajo el poder de una revelación interior y de una inspiración repentina. Es la manifestación sobrenatural de una verdad oculta o de un secreto divino hecho por Dios para un bien general de la Iglesia y para utilidad particular del favorecido. Es también lo que nos dice el padre Emiliano Tardif. En su experiencia personal dice que es como una palabra insistente que llega al interior, que llega a la mente, que no es creada por el hombre, que es colocada por el Espíritu Santo y motivada para el Espíritu Santo para dar una buena noticia a una persona o a una asamblea, para expresar un acontecimiento que quiere el Señor que sea conocido. La ciencia es la gracia que presupone hacer y gustar el alma las verdades divinas por medio del razonamiento, nos dice Santo Tomás. que muestra su armonía y su belleza y por medio de analogías y ejemplos tomados de la naturaleza ayudan a entender. Es la facultad de comunicar y demostrar las verdades de la religión, hablando Santo Tomás de lo que es la ciencia. ¿En qué consiste entonces este carisma de conocimiento? Y vuelvo a nombrar al padre Emiliano. Es la comunicación de una seguridad interior, de una certeza que no se adquiere a partir de una reflexión o una deducción. Y diría yo que no se adquiere por fuerza humana, ni por conocimiento, ni por sabiduría humana. Es parecido a lo que la liturgia nos dice constantemente a través de la palabra en el libro de Primero de Reyes, cuando nos habla de Salomón y cuando nos habla de esa sabiduría, de ese conocimiento que tenía Salomón, de ese poder descubrir la acción del Espíritu en los acontecimientos y en las personas en una asamblea. No olvidemos nosotros que esa palabra de conocimiento se da, mis hermanos, a través de una oración profunda. Los carismas se dan en un clima de oración profundo. Los carismas hay que pedirlos al Espíritu Santo. Hoy más que nunca necesitamos esa palabra de conocimiento. Miren ustedes que muchas veces se toma de una manera casi igual lo que es palabra de sabiduría, palabra de conocimiento, profecía y todos estos carismas. Pero cada uno tiene, digamos, como una especificación. Cuando hablamos de la profecía, tendríamos que hablar nosotros de la vocación misma desde el bautismo de cada uno de nosotros a ser los verdaderos profetas del Señor para anunciar la buena noticia, para iluminar todos los acontecimientos de la vida desde la acción poderosa del Señor. Y podríamos hablar también de esa sabiduría que adquieren muchas personas que no son intelectuales. Aún podría decir yo que son iletrados, pero que tienen una gran sabiduría espiritual. Una gran sabiduría espiritual. Hace varios años estaba en una vereda colombiana, en un cantón, dicen algunos, y empecé a ver que un campesino le estaba hablando a un grupo de personas, un campesino carismático, y le estaba hablando del Vaticano II y estaba explicando el Vaticano II en la Lumen Gentium. Y a mí me impactó eso. Y después de que él terminó esa enseñanza, oiga, de una gran sabiduría y un gran conocimiento, yo le pregunté que quién le había enseñado eso. Y empecé a hablar con él, Ignacio se llamaba, y él empezó a decirme que había estudiado hasta tercero de primaria, que ese libro se lo había encontrado en un bus, y que él se había enamorado de ese libro y que todos los días lo leía y que en la oración él le pedía al Señor que le diera el conocimiento para sencillamente la sabiduría espiritual para poder expresarse. Pero también en esa misma asamblea yo veía que este señor oraba por toda la gente en la asamblea y habían palabras de conocimiento en esa asamblea. Y también le decía que cómo se suscitaba eso en él. Y él me decía, son palabras que llegan a mí de una manera insistente, que el Señor me invita a que sean proclamadas y yo siento paz y tranquilidad y como un descanso cuando yo las digo. Y a veces me da miedo, decía él, porque a veces pienso que son suposiciones mías, que salgo de mi conocimiento, de mi mente, pero sencillamente a veces me quedo yo como sin expresar, pero el Señor como que me insiste de una manera tierna, diría, maravillosa, para que yo exprese a la comunidad esa buena noticia. No son acontecimientos de futuro, son acontecimientos del presente. ¿Cuántos de nosotros no necesitamos palabras de sabiduría a través del diálogo, a través de la oración en grupo, a través de un acontecimiento o de un problema o de una dificultad? ¿Cuántos de nosotros no necesitamos esa palabra? ¿Y cuántos de ustedes no tienen ese don y ese carisma del Espíritu Santo, de esa palabra maravillosa de conocimiento, de todo lo que está sucediendo en una asamblea, de todo lo que está sucediendo en una persona? Y quiero hacer como un paréntesis: el Señor nunca nos revela el pecado de nadie. Eso es muy importante, hermano, que lo sepamos. Y por eso los carismas se tienen que discernir. Los carismas se tienen que orar, los carismas se tienen que pedir, con los carismas nos tenemos que identificar. Los carismas no hacen más santo a nadie. Los carismas son un servicio para la comunidad. Mis queridos hermanos, que cada uno de nosotros estemos sirviéndole al Señor. Y terminemos con unas palabras de Monseñor Alfonso Uribe Caramillo, que nos dice: el carisma de la palabra de ciencia es el diagnóstico que Dios hace de un hecho, de un problema, de un estado de ánimo, de una situación que comunica a nuestra mente. Oiga, qué tan importante eso que comunica a nuestra mente. Dios quiere muchas veces participarnos conocimientos concretos con un fin especial. Y lo hace mediante este carisma, cuya utilidad es mayor de lo que suponemos. En la Sagrada Escritura encontramos muchos casos en los cuales aparece este carisma. Por ejemplo, el profeta Natán descubre el pecado de David y conoce también que ha sido perdonado. Y vuelvo a decir, porque entre paréntesis decía que el Señor no descubre el pecado de nadie, pero en este caso de David, el Señor, como que sencillamente, no paulatinamente a través de Natán, sino que le coloca como esa parábola y le dice Natán a David: tú eres esa persona, esa persona. Saúl recibe noticias del paradero de las asnas que buscaba. Pedro conoce que llegan los que han conducirlo a la casa de Cornelio en el capítulo 10 de Hechos de los Apóstoles. Ananías tiene el conocimiento sobrenatural de la presencia de Pablo en Damasco y de su conversión. Pedro conoce mediante este carisma la mentira de Ananías y de Zafira. En las vidas de los santos, como el párroco cura de Ars, o también como San Juan Bosco, Santa Catalina de Siena, aparecen este carisma con mucha frecuencia y siempre con función benéfica de una o de varias personas. Pero ese carisma no está solamente para los santos, está para nosotros pecadores también ese carisma. Pidámosle al Señor la gracia, agradezcamos al Señor los carismas, agradezcamos este año jubilar en el Perú, agradezcamos todas estas conferencias virtuales a través de este programa Veni Creator Spiritu. Que el Señor los bendiga y que volvamos a la fuente y que tengamos sentido de pertenencia en la renovación carismática, en el nombre del Padre y del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. Amén.
The next part of the healing service is that I pray for words of knowledge, asking the Lord what conditions he wants to heal that night. And I receive them in different ways, but I proclaim them and I say, I believe God is healing people with these conditions. And then when I actually proclaim that, people respond in faith, often receiving healing as the word is given. Sometimes during the service, I have people wave their arms if they are healed. If they're 80% or better, I'll have them wave their arms and I have them come forward and talk with someone and share what happened. And if they're 100% healed, sometimes I'll stop the service and I'll actually have them testify to everyone what just happened. And in some services, I do this actually a lot. 20 minutes because I want people to know that Jesus is active and he's already healing people, and that gives people faith that God can heal them as well. I'm just going to start giving words of knowledge. Stay in a period of prayer. If the words of knowledge describe you in any way, I want you to try to do something you couldn't do before. Try to see if there's any tingling or heat going on whatsoever. I got a word of knowledge of someone's right thumb. I also got a fractured hand. Someone's hand has been fractured, someone's right thumb.
And then the priest says, he senses someone with a right thumb. And I was like, oh, well, I injured my right thumb. So I start bending it, and I could never do this. Well, I could never do this, but after the injury, and so I go up there, and I'm healed.
I got the word, like a metatarsal in the foot. Maybe it's the fifth metatarsal. I don't know what foot that is. But to someone, someone's foot is being healed.
Well, I had a broken metatarsal bone in my foot, and there's no pain.
No pain, and she doesn't need the boot anymore. Walk around, show us.
I also have bones in the neck. There's bones in the neck that needed healing, and God is healing that right now.
All right, I have Michelle with me right here. She had level 9 back pain, or level 9 pain in her neck that went to a 2. What happened when he prayed?
There was a lot of warmth, no tingling, but all of a sudden the pain's gone.
So there was warmth, the Holy Spirit came upon her neck, and the pain is completely gone. Let's give it up for God.
Someone's hips hurt, especially when they walk. It might not be when they sit, it might not be when they stand, but there's walking, like a hip pain when you're walking. If that's you, receive that. If that's you, receive that in the name of Jesus.
I do have some arthritis in my hips. I was praying for other things, but I felt all this tingling like around my hips. And so he said, well, is anything better? And I thought, well, that isn't what I was praying for, but I had this tingling and I do have arthritis a little bit. And so he said to try something that you couldn't do before, so I just kept popping up and down.
In the middle of someone's back, straight in the middle of the back, there's a severe misalignment, which is causing a lot of pain. The Lord is bringing that into alignment right now. It's like right below the scapula, but kind of between them. There's something right there that God is healing right now. Thank you, Lord.
Okay, Amy, you had some pain in your
scapula.
Scapula, awesome. And Amy, you said before we started tonight, your pain level was at an 8 or a 9.
I couldn't lift my arm.
She couldn't lift her arm. And Amy, where's your pain level right now?
It's gone.
It's completely, completely gone. Amen.
Last week, we had a word for people with scoliosis. Two women were healed on the spot. They felt their spines aligning right at that moment. And they were completely healed. So if you have scoliosis, in the name of Jesus, be healed.
Grace, could you tell everyone your condition?
Yes, I have a problem with scoliosis and lordosis, and for the past year I have been with a lot of pain. I can't.
How much pain out of 10 on a daily basis?
9.5.
9.5.
And every day I have pain during the morning. When I get up, when I go, I have to put a towel under my neck in order for me to not to have so much pain. I have to roll the towel and put it under my back and my neck.
And what happened when Father prayed?
I feel chilly, and then a vibration all over my body. And asked me to test, and I test back, and I don't have no pain.
So what's your pain level at now?
Nothing.
Nothing. Amen. Can you demonstrate? Whoa, scoliosis no more. Thank you, Father.
Another misconception is that many Catholics are afraid to seek spiritual gifts. They're afraid to ask God for them. And they may have read in the writings of some of the saints and some of the great spiritual teachers of our Catholic tradition that you shouldn't seek experiences of God and that you should be very cautious about seeking any gifts because they might lead to pride. You might deceive yourself. Now, that is absolutely true if you're talking about extraordinary mystical phenomena, which God gives at his own discretion for the benefit of the individual in their own spiritual life. Those are different from the charisms of the Holy Spirit. the spiritual gifts distributed by the Holy Spirit among all the faithful for the building up of the body. So spiritual gifts are not for the person who receives them. They are to give away to others. They are because God wants to bless others through you. And in fact, Paul says in Scripture, earnestly desire the spiritual gifts.
Pope Francis has continually called the church into mission. In a recent homily, he said, "The way of the church is precisely to leave her four walls behind and go out in search of those who are distant, those essentially on the outskirts of life." Father Matthias connected us with his friends, Patrick and Aaron, from Encounter Ministries, who helped him at the healing service. Having been discipled in the spiritual gifts, they put them to use in the service of evangelization to bring the gospel to everyone they meet in their city of Columbus, Ohio.
My friends Patrick and Aaron are filled with the Holy Spirit, and they just give God a blank check to do whatever He wants with them. And so they get together, they have adoration, prayer, and fellowship, but then they sit down and they pray and they say, "Lord, who do you want us to touch today? How do you want to touch them? How do you want to bring your love? How do you want us to speak about your love to people? Show us what you want." And that radical availability to the Holy Spirit allows God to give that inspiration so that they can go out and proclaim Jesus to people that they don't even know they're going to meet.
Okay, I saw an image of an elderly black man, and I got this sense. I asked the Lord what that meant, and He said that this guy had a son. He had like a son, and the son was estranged from him. And then I asked the Lord what that meant, and He said that I'm supposed to declare that the Lord is going to restore his relationship with his son. And then I asked Him where that guy is, and I got an image of the men's shelter, that he's somewhere around the men's shelter, just a few blocks away from here.
I got a couple names, David, maybe James, and that we're supposed to pray for healing in either hands or eyes.
So not knowing exactly what God had planned for that afternoon, we, in faith, jumped into Patrick's car and drove to the first place that the Lord had revealed to us in prayer that we were supposed to be headed. It was a men's shelter here in town. And we were looking for the man that met the description that the Lord had given us in prayer. We were looking for an elderly African-American gentleman. And as we pulled up, we realized that he was nowhere to be seen, right? We pulled in front of the men's shelter. And across the street is this gathering of all young men who looked slightly intimidating to us at the moment. And we parked the car, committed to, you know, living out the experience that we committed that day to. And we opened up the doors and got out of the car and closed the doors behind us and started to head across the street, thinking, well, maybe, you know, we got the details wrong a little bit. As we were walking around the car, we heard a couple of voices coming from an alley that was right in front of where we had parked. Behind a row of trash cans, we round the corner and we find these two elderly African-American gentlemen meeting the description perfectly of who we had set out to find. So we were pretty enthused at that point. And we walked up to them and we said, "Hey, you know, this is gonna sound super weird, but we were just at church praying and the Lord invited us to come out and to look for someone who looked kind of like you." And they were actually more surprised than we were when all this lined up, because they had just been praying through Scripture and they were just having this conversation about how God does amazing things. And they agreed to pray with us. And as we entered into prayer with them, all the words that the Lord had revealed to us just started to make sense.
Yes, sir.
Maxwell, do you have a son?
Yes.
Okay. When we were praying back at the church, I just got this word that I was going to pray with a man that had a son that was apart from him, right, was strange. And the word that I got was that the Lord wanted to bring restoration. He wants to reconcile the son to the father. So are you guys estranged at all?
Well, he's in Florida. Okay. I'm here from Florida. We don't spend a lot of time together because I think him and myself and his mother, you know, became divided. Mm-hmm. You know, he spent more time with his mother. then, you know, you get spirit. I was trying to get him here. But for some reason, it didn't work out.
Can I just pray for that restoration for you? So, Father, I just thank you for the gift of this man. I thank you for the word that you gave me, Lord, that he would have that that restored relationship, Lord. You sent us out here to. I saw an image of an older black man that I was supposed to come over this way and pray with and declare that the relationship between the Son and the Father is going to be reconciled.
Yes.
Because he brought a ministry of reconciliation. Yes. So, Father, we release your reconciliation, yes, your mercy, yes, and your healing over this man, over his son.
That is truly amazing. God is awesome. It's like...
So, after praying with Maxwell, Patrick and I were so excited that what the Lord had revealed to us in our time of prayer had struck true. So we gave high fives and figured that this was a successful day and started walking back to the car. Not even 10 seconds after we left the conversation, a guy shouts to us from across the street and he says, "Hey, what are you guys doing?" So we explained to him pretty jubilantly and excited at this point that we were praying with people. We asked him if he wanted to pray and he said, "Yeah, I'll be right over." So he starts walking to us.
What's your name?
David Catlett.
David, I'm Patrick Rice.
Tell us
about
how
to meet you. I just left the hospital. Okay. Broke my finger. Okay.
How much pain is in your finger right
now? About a 5. A 5? Can we pray for that?
Yeah.
Right now?
This finger right here.
This finger. What's your name again?
David Edward Calloway.
David?
You ever heard of Cap Calloway?
Yeah.
That's my great uncle.
David, we were praying at the church, and the Lord told us that we were going to meet a guy named David. So, Father, you've sent us to be with a man named David. So, Father, we just release your grace, your favor, your healing touch upon this finger. I command all pain to leave this finger in Jesus' name right now. I pray for complete restoration over this finger in Jesus' name right now. David, how's your finger feel?
It feels wonderful.
Bye, David.
In another area of the union, Aaron met a student named Carrie. While they spoke, Patrick was interceding behind the camera.
Okay, so I grew up Catholic.
Okay.
I was raised Catholic.
In Cleveland. Most people are, I think.
I went to, the area I'm from Lakewood. I don't know if you know anything about it.
It sounds familiar. I've been up to Cleveland a couple times.
Catholic. Like I went to Catholic grade school for all 8 years. Went to a Catholic high school for 4 mm-hmm. years. And then I came here, so
okay.
I don't know, it was part of growing up. For me.
Okay, so Catholic grade school, Catholic high school, part of growing up, mm-hmm. and what's happened since you came to Ohio State?
I don't know, I guess I've gotten more distant.
Mm-hmm.
I don't go to church every week or anything like that. I'll go to church like when I go home to visit my mom because she likes me to go with her, so I'll do that.
Guess what, we're here in what's this room called?
The flag room.
The flag room. Understandably so. We're here in the flag room, and I bet that no one has ever prayed in the flag room before for an encounter with God, but I wonder if you'd be open to praying just that God would come and be present in your heart.
Do I have to say it?
No.
Oh, okay.
You just get to sit there and receive.
Yeah, I would love to.
Are you open to that?
Sure.
Okay. God wants to speak to us. How silly would it be for a father who loves us with his whole heart to only talk when we come and ask him to talk to us? That's not real.
Mm-hmm.
God's talking to us every day. It's just us kind of putting ourselves in a place where we can actually hear his voice. So I believe that if we ask God a simple question right now, that he's going to give us an answer.
Okay.
So eyes closed, hands open.
Hands again?
I don't need your hands.
Okay.
Whatever. But we're going to pray. Holy Spirit, that you would come. And we're going to ask you a simple question, God, and we're going to expect a simple answer in response. So... Carrie, repeat after me, okay? Father.
Father.
What do you think of me right now?
What do you think of me right now?
Okay, now we're gonna wait for a word, and the first word that comes to your mind, I just want you to be bold and answer that out. Was there a word that kind of came to your mind when you said that?
Yeah, but I don't know.
What word was it?
Power.
Okay, power. Do you want power?
I don't know.
Do you want power? Power is sweet.
Know.
All right. What does power remind you of?
I don't know. I don't...
Good. Is there something going on in your heart right now?
I don't know what's happening.
Okay. What are you feeling?
I don't really know. It's been a while since I've prayed.
That's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay.
While Aaron was praying for Carrie, I was behind the camera. So I started asking the Lord for specific details about her life and what he wanted to say.
That's a blessing. Good. Awesome.
I have a question. Did you play volleyball at some point?
I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want me to keep going? You played in high school?
Yeah.
Okay. And when you were close, did you certain teammates, like, particularly close?
Yeah.
Okay. Are you not close with some of them now? I just saw the Lord show me an image when we were praying of you going down for a dig, like you were a girl. You're right? I don't know.
Go for it. Yeah, go.
All right. And then there was something that happened with girls on the team, and it created, like, huge problems between you guys, and he just brought that up. Is that true?
Are you guys, like, psychics?
Just Jesus.
Anyways, I got the sense that there's something that happened with the girl on a volleyball team, and that it creates some tension, and the Lord doesn't want there to be tension, and that he wants to restore a relationship. Mm. And if there's anyone you need to forgive, like, all you got to do is forgive that person.
I'm crying again.
It's okay. All you got to do is forgive that person, and he's going to, like, actually restore the friendship that was once really, really tight. And it's good. He loves you. And
can we? Do you want to do that? Do you want to pray forgiveness?
Can you pray for you one more time?
This is so good.
Lead you in that forgiveness.
Okay. So, Jesus.
Jesus.
In your name.
In your name.
And by your power.
By your power.
I forgive.
I forgive.
And who do you want to forgive? I don't even know them.
Do I have to say a name?
Yeah, say a name.
Julie. Aaron, yeah. Sure.
Mm-hmm. And I release.
And I release.
Any anger. That had laid hold of my life. Mm-hmm. Let's try another one, Jesus.
Jesus.
I forgive.
Myself. For stepping out of relationship with you.
And for lack of faith.
In
what you want to do in my life.
In Jesus.
I accept. Your plan for my life.
And yeah, like, he just loves that you forgave just like he forgave from the cross. So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, amen. Scientists, just Christians.
I don't believe it.
Oh, God bless you, girl. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
A word of knowledge is when the Holy Spirit reveals to us a fact about a person's life that is either objectively true or false. We see that Jesus uses this in Scripture in the story of the woman at the well, right? In their conversation together, her major breakthrough experience happened when the Lord revealed to her facts about her life, about her husband's, about her history, to the point where she moves from a place of unbelief to a place of going out to others and saying, come and meet the man who told me everything about myself. In our conversation with Carrie, we saw a similar thing take place. We saw her move from a place of incredulity to an amazing encounter experience, and the breakthrough moment was when we were able to reveal to her a word that the Lord had spoken into our hearts. So at the conclusion of our conversation with Carrie, she was just so eager and excited to be invested in the next step of her faith walk. So at the conclusion of our time, we connected her with a local faith community so that she can continue to develop that relationship with Jesus.